Hello and welcome to this video session on inter-integrated circuit I2C bus for Peak microcontroller 16F877A. Myself, Mr. Vipul Kondekar from Walchand Institute of Technology, Solapur. So these are the learning outcomes of this video session. So student will be able to describe I2C module, its master and slave configuration with the help of block diagram, as well as student will be able to implement the interfacing of any peripheral device which supports I2C protocol to the microcontroller. So these are the contents of this presentation. So we'll have a brief introduction, then we will go for various control registers associated with this I2C protocol for Peak microcontroller. Then we will see how we can have interconnection, means when you get different peripherals which are to be interconnected, they are supporting I2C protocol. So how we can have interconnection between them. And at the end, we will try to understand the operation of the master and slave module of Peak microcontroller for this I2C with the help of block diagram. Now, this I2C protocol bus is one of the important, quite popular, versatile, widely used protocol. You'll find in most of the embedded systems. What are the reasons behind that? So one of the important aspects of I2C is its hardware efficiency. So when we will see the interconnection of this I2C protocol, only two pins are required for this interconnection. And hence, the circuit becomes simple. Not only this, when you are using these two lines, out of these two lines, one line is used for, the lines are bidirectional. One line is used for data communication, another is used for the clock signal. Whenever you have I2C bus compatible devices, so you can have effective communication between those devices because those devices have got on-chip interface. And this on-chip interface available on those I2C compatible devices allows them to communicate directly with each other by taking the help of this I2C bus connection between the two devices. I2C protocol support. It can support up to 128 different devices attached onto the same bus. So many peripherals you can connect onto the same bus when you are going for this I2C protocol. And few examples of that is whenever you are having some embedded system developments, some memory is required, so serial E2 prompts are available. So they are I2C supporting E2 forms. So you can use this I2C interface. IO expander, real-time clock ICs are available, serial ADCs, serial DAC, some sensors are available. All these things we can have interface to the microcontroller by taking the help of only two pins of the microcontroller. If I2C protocol is supported there. Now, this is what is the simplicity of the I2C protocol. So when you want to have the interfacing, suppose this is a microcontroller, this is a master device. So only two pins, serial data and serial clock. These are the two pins used. And this is one I2C bus. This is a common I2C bus. These bus lines are pulled high by using these two pull-up registers. And then whenever you want to have interfacing of I2C compatible device, let us say device 1, 2, 3, up to N, we have seen that up to 128 different devices we can connect here. So these devices are also taking the help of only two pins. There are two pins are used for interconnection. So this is one typical interconnection. Let us try to understand same thing with the help of one, what we can say, embedded system diagram where a microcontroller is there. And your requirement is you want to interface different peripherals like accelerometer is required, let us say, serial E2 prom is required, your application requires RTC, real-time clock and OLED. So if these are your requirements and you want to have the communication between them, so you can take the help of this I2C bus And this is how a typical interconnection can be made between these various I2C compatible devices to form a very simple, efficient interconnectivity for the communication. As far as the peak microcontroller is concerned, so as we discussed, MSSP is the module and it supports I2C. So this I2C mode, it is implemented in all master and slave functions. All the functions are supported for the peak microcontroller, including general call support. As well, it supports, it can generate interrupt. So this I2C module can generate interrupt on start and stop bits in hardware to determine the free bus. As we have seen that so many peripherals are connected onto the same bus, so there may be the problem of collision. If more than two devices are transmitting their data onto the same lines, you will get collision of the data. And to avoid that, so this type of facilities are used. So again, this module is implemented in standard mode specifications, as well as 7 and 10 bit addressing is used. So when you say where you are interfacing so many peripherals to the microcontroller, so how you are identifying a particular peripheral in that network, so addressing is done for that. So these are the features, some of the features. And when you want to implement this particular I2C protocol, so what hardware, as we discussed, only two pins are required. So as far as the peak microcontroller 16F877A is concerned, so the two pins of port C, RC3 and RC4, so they are working as SCL, serial clock pin, and serial data pin respectively. So these are the two pins used as far as the hardware part is concerned. And these are the various special function registers, control registers, which are used for this MSSP module, I2C, for the I2C operation. So it starts with SSP control register. Control 1 register, control 2 registers are there. SSP status register is used, SSP buffer, all these registers we will see when we will see the block diagram of this I2C module. So one buffer register is there, one shift register is there. We know that when you have the data available to you in file register, if you want to send the data, is in the parallel form. So that parallel data is to be converted into serial. So you require this shift register. And as well as we said, different around 128 devices can be connected in this I2C bus, onto this I2C bus. So we have this unique feature, this address register is available, so that you can have unique addresses for all the peripherals. So these are the special function registers, these are the various registers, and these are two hardware pins required for this I2C communication. Now, as we have discussed, when you want to write a program for I2C communication, so that I2C communication you will be controlling by taking the help of different control registers. So these are the control registers used for I2C communication: SSP status register, which has got this file address 94H. One more register, SSP CON 1 register is used, as well as this SSP CON 2. So SSP CON 1, SSP CON 2, and SSP STAT. These are the three important registers you need to deal with whenever you are writing the program for peak microcontrollers I2C communication. Now, let us try to understand how this I2C module is working with the help of what internal hardware is present. So there are two parts. Either you are working as a master or you are working as a slave. So this talks about the master mode operation. When peak microcontroller works in the master mode operation, and then we can have comparison, what is the difference between master mode operation and compare mode operation as far as this block diagram is concerned. So if you look at this block diagram, so as we discussed, these are the two pins used. So on this pin, clock will be sent, and on this particular pin, data will be either sent or received. As we said, this device is master. So one more responsibility of the master device in the serial communication, synchronous serial communication, is it has to generate the clock. And hence, you'll find this particular clock generation part. So this baud rate generator, by taking the help of this SSP add bit number 0 to 6, you can generate different baud rates, and this clock can be generated here. This clock is given to other slave devices in the network, as well as the same clock is used by this master for sending as well as receiving the data. And then this is the SDA pin. So this is a bidirectional, either you will be sending the data or receiving the data. Now, as let us discuss this part, this new thing as compared to the SPI mode, that this SSP add register is there. So here you will configure the address for a particular device. And whenever another device wants to communicate, initially it will send the address to whom it wants to communicate. And then that data will be received here, and then you will check whether the address with which a particular device wants to communicate is your address. If you find this address match, then only the device will start accepting the data. So this is what is the feature available. Along with that, to have the control of error control of this particular communication, so or framing part, so this start and stop bits detection and generation block diagram is there. So this will result into set or clear of the S and clear and set of the P bit in this SSP set. So this is the what you can say one important block as far as the start and stop bits are concerned. So this is the block diagram of the master. And as we know that when you are sending the data is available on the file register. From the file register, it will go here and write to the SSP buff will be the operation. And when you write the data in synchronization with the clock generated, that data will get converted, that this SSP SR shift register will convert that data, okay, into the serial form, and then that data will go on to the SDA line. If you are receiving the data, again that received data will be available in SSP R shift register, then it will be available to SSP buff, and then you can read that data. Received data you can read here onto the internal bus. So this is the block diagram of the master. Now, just we'll go for the block diagram of the slave and just see what are the differences here. The most important thing on slave, you will not find any clock generator, border generation circuit. Most of the part is same. One more difference you'll find is, it is start and stop bit detection circuit. Let us go to the previous slide. This border generator part was there, and start and stop, detect and generate. Both the parts were there. Both the functions were performed here in the master mode. But if you come to this slave mode, you'll find that only start bit, stop bit detection part is taking place as far as the slave is concerned. As well, it is not generating any clock signal. It will be taking the help of clock signal generated by some another master present in the communication module in the given network. So the clock signal which is received on SCL will be used for sending the data as well as receiving the data. And all other operations, this SSP add register and match detection part is same as that of the master. So this is how, this is the hardware present inside the Peak microcontroller with which, with the help of which it supports this I2C protocol, and you can have in very simple way communication between the I2C compatible devices. Now, just think, now we know SPI, I2C, so can you list out the differences you find between the SPI protocol and I2C protocol as far as some hardware and software aspects are concerned? These are the references used for this video presentation.